Hello, Fiction of Science, to Welcome and a History Readers, How Alex I'm, and Is 35 Episode This, Wibbly Wobbly Timey Wimey. This is my second episode about time travel. In the last episode, I talked about the major signpost titles of the genre from 1980 till today, but that is only scratching the surface. Honestly, I could probably do a dozen episodes with all the stuff that's out there. If someone wants to do a podcast just about time travel, have at it. But for this podcast, time travel is only one slice of science fiction, albeit a large one. The most interesting thing about time travel, I think, is the wide variety of ways in which it's used. Because it can range anywhere from a strict, fixed continuity, like in The Time Traveler's Wife, all the way to no continuity, hence the episode title. The phrase, Wibbly Wobbly Timey Wimey, comes from the Doctor Who episode Blink, where the Doctor uses it to describe the weirdness of how time works. Quote, "People assume that time is a strict progression of cause to effect, but actually, from a non-linear, non-subjective viewpoint, it's more like a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff." Unquote. The timey-wimey ball is considered to be a trope for stories in which the rules of time travel are not consistent, and the continuity gets all tangled up. Though ironically, Blink is one of the least wibbly-wobbly and most rigorous Doctor Who episodes in terms of continuity. So, for this episode, I want to give an overview of how time travel works, the different ways that it's used by different writers. As I said in the last episode, there's a lot of material, but I think I've whittled it down to something manageable. Hopefully. This may be a bad idea. But let's do it anyway. We are going to go on a whirlwind tour of 10 time travel tropes, which will give an overview of the most important variations you'll see in the genre. And if I don't show up in a time machine from the future to tell myself not to do this, I'll assume that it all works out. Nope, nothing. Let's get to it. Number 1. The earliest version of the time travel motif in literature, so ancient and so far removed that I hesitate to call it time travel at all, is the Rip Van Winkle story. Rip Van Winkle, of course, is the famous short story by Washington Irving, in which a man drinks some suspicious liquor given to him by the ghost of Henry Hudson and falls asleep for 20 years. When he returns home, no one recognizes him, and he slept through the entire American Revolution. Washington Irving didn't come up with the idea from scratch, though. Not by a long shot. There is, of course, the Sleeping Beauty story, legends of fairyland where time runs strangely, and similar fairy tale-like stories in other cultures. And even those are nowhere near the beginning. 3 separate religious stories, all dating back at least as far as the 3rd to 5th century, describe men either sleeping for a long time or spending time in heaven while many years pass on earth. The Jewish story of Choni Ha Ma'egel, the Hindu story of King Kakudmi, and the Christian and later Islamic story of the 7 sleepers of Ephesus. The King Kakudmi story in the Mahabharata is particularly unusual, as the calendar system used there indicates that over 100 million years have passed. It's fitting that these stories are the oldest form of time travel in literature, when, as far as we know, it's also the only form of time travel that's possible in the real world. As, when you travel close to the speed of light, time slows down so that a short trip from your subjective point of view may take many years for the rest of the universe. Poole Anderson famously explored this in Tau Zero. And this general trope of time travel to the future appears in many stories, usually with some form of suspended animation. H.G. Wells's When the Sleeper Wakes, Buck Rogers's origin story, Idiocracy, but sometimes with time dilation, as in Flight of the Navigator and Gene Roddenberry's Andromeda, or occasionally with some kind of portal or magic going on. The main point of these stories is usually to get a present-day person into a wildly different future, with some combination of future shock at the high technology or picking up the pieces after some kind of disaster. But as I said, it's barely time travel as we normally think of it. More of a plot device where the details are unimportant. You could just as easily do it with the characters getting abducted by aliens, Guardians of the Galaxy style. Time travel is a lot more evident and a lot more interesting when you can go back in time. Although oddly enough, the earliest examples of that are also not really time travel in the usual sense. Number two on my list is the letter from the future. This is where someone receives a warning from the future about some disaster that is coming, in hopes of preventing it. The book, often cited as the first time travel story, Samuel Madden's Memoirs of the 20th Century, is written as a series of letters from a bad future sent for just this purpose. Although bad future in this context means the Catholics have taken over the world. But more than that, the central point of what I consider to be the first time travel novel, A Christmas Carol, is to warn Ebenezer Scrooge about the bad future he's in for. That one's a bit of an unusual case, since Scrooge travels to the future to see it for himself, but the idea is the same. Actually, maybe this trope should be called Fixing a Bad Future. Bad Future is the TV trope's name for it, after all, and the time travel typically doesn't take the form of a simple message. Gregory Benford's Timescape, which I discussed in the last episode, is a classic example where it does. However, it's more common for a person to come back in time to bring the message, like in The Terminator. Ditto for more recent movies like Looper or X-Men Days of Future Past. But they all have the same idea of fixing a bad future. Even so, I still consider this trope to be a borderline case. Most of the action happens in the present, and in many cases, you could pull off the same story with a prophecy or something. No, we are looking for a story that you couldn't do without time travel. Number three. The next trope to show up in the historical record is all about going back into history. But I don't mean just any exploring of history. I call this one Back in Time to Stay, because these are stories where, usually by accident but occasionally by choice, a group of people wind up stranded in the past and stay there. This is the sort of story that's typified by Mark Twain's A Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court. And sure, you could do like in Firefly or even Star Trek a lot of the time and visit a rustic, undeveloped planet, but that's not Earth history. To visit history, you need a time machine. It sort of makes sense that this was the next trope to be invented after the bad future stories. With a bad future, you have a message or time traveler from the future, but most of the action takes place in the present. Here, you have a time traveler from the present going back, and most of the action happens in the past. Admittedly, this is kind of a matter of perspective. X-Men Days of Future Past goes back from the future of 2014 to the present of 1973, but you get the idea. Connecticut Yankee is probably the classic example of this trope, with a time traveler introducing modern technology to the medieval era. It's a less common one, but it's picked up a lot in recent years. One very important book of this type is S.M. Sterling's Island in the Sea of Time, in which the entire island of Nantucket is mysteriously transported from the then-present of 1998 to around 1250 BC, at the time of the Trojan War. This kind of story has since become very popular in the alternate history community on the internet. In fact, today, a story where an entire landmass or group of people gets transported back in time is known simply as an ISOT, after Island in the Sea of Time. And Sterling wasn't the only author to do this. Just a couple years later, Eric Flint wrote the arguably better known 1632, where the fictional town of Grantville is transported from West Virginia in 2000 to 1631 in the middle of the Holy Roman Empire. Later books, open to submissions from other authors, have people from several different time periods being tossed together. In 2003, Arthur C. Clarke and Stephen Baxter took this a step further with their Time Odyssey series. In something of an inversion of the Space Odyssey series, this series starts with malicious aliens meddling with Earth. They take chunks of the world from all over history and turn the entire planet into a patchwork of different time periods. I do want to note one unusual case here as well. In most of these stories, the time travel is random or imposed by outside forces. However, in the 2011 TV show Terra Nova, it is intentional. In that show, people discover a time portal to a parallel Earth in the Cretaceous period, and intentionally build a colony there to escape the environmental collapse on their 22nd century Earth. That's something you don't see very often, but I think it has potential. Oh, and I should mention that this is where time travel overlaps the most with alternate history, so you may be thinking of a few more titles in that vein, but that one's getting its own episode later, so stay tuned for that. Number 4. This one is kind of the opposite. We've seen stories about people getting stuck in history, but if they have control over the time machine or whatever they're using, they're frequently just going for a visit. And often, it's not even to meddle with history, at least not deliberately. It really is just going for a visit. This is time tourism. In fact, this is sort of what H.G. Wells' time traveler did in The Time Machine, although he only went to the future. This is basically the motivation of Connie Willis's time travelers in Doomsday Book and its sequels, which I discussed in the last episode. Not tourism per se, but historical research. After all, there's never as much evidence as we'd like about what happened in history. Why not just go back and see it for yourself? Tourism is also the motivation of the safari in Ray Bradbury's A Sound of Thunder, and Lazarus Long's trip in Robert Heinlein's Time Enough for Love, and probably any show where some mad scientist wants to go back in time for science! This is something that lends itself well to episodic series, most famously with Doctor Who. The Doctor's TARDIS travels through time and space, which is very convenient for the writers to visit various parts of Earth's history every other episode. Since it involves visiting many different parts of history instead of just one, it's also something that lends itself well to children's shows, where it can be a device for educational programs about history, or even prehistory, as in the PBS show Dinosaur Train, or it can just be used for comedic messing around with history. The old animated shorts of Peabody's Improbable History and the recent film based on them, Mr. Peabody and Sherman, may be the most famous example of the latter case. One interesting variation on this is the fetch quest, where the time travelers need to retrieve something from the past for some reason. They don't or can't change the past, but they need something from there that they can't get in the future. Think Star Trek IV rescuing the extinct whales, 12 Monkeys, where they need a clean sample of a pandemic virus, and of course Avengers Endgame with the Infinity Stones. But usually, people aren't just visiting or going on a fetch quest when they go back in time. They actually want to change the past. Number 5 on my list of time travel tropes is by far the most common kind of time travel story, which is any sort of meddling with time. There are far too many of these to name. They start with A Christmas Carol and continue on from there. Fixing a bad future is a subcategory of this, but more often the time travelers break something in the past themselves and have to fix it again. Back to the Future is the go-to movie here. Marty breaks the timeline by preventing his parents from meeting and has to fix it. And in Part 2, Biff does it again by giving his past self knowledge of the future to make lots of money. Usually, unlike fixing a bad future, these changes to the timeline get reversed by the end of the movie, and everything is back to normal. Doubly so if it's a TV show where status quo is God. Although surprisingly, that doesn't always happen. The Sci-Fi Channel TV show Eureka was a rare exception where changes to the timeline were not reset, and all of seasons 4 and 5 took place in a permanent alternate timeline. You can find plenty of variations on this one, too. For example, if people are messing with time, why not have some time police to stop them? You may be thinking of Isaac Asimov's The End of Eternity, the Time Cop movies, or DC's Legends of Tomorrow, among others. But this seems to have started with Poole Anderson. In 1955, the same year as The End of Eternity, Anderson kicked off what is arguably a purer example with his Time Patrol series, about an agency tasked with protecting the timeline from renegade time travelers. This series grew to many short stories and eventually two novels in his later years. Another unusual variation is where the time travelers have to fix something in history that's already broken, as in, what actually happened doesn't match what was recorded or needs to happen. For example, in Michael Moorcock's novel Behold the Man, a traveler goes back to the first century to meet Jesus, only to fail to find anyone who matches the description. So instead, he steps into the historical role of Jesus himself to ensure history unfolds as it is supposed to. Overall, meddling with time is the most popular version of time travel, but it's also the one where continuity starts to break down. Even if the rules of time travel are self-consistent in a story, and they aren't always, they often don't make logical sense. Which is to be expected, because when you start meddling with time, you pretty quickly run into paradoxes. The solution to this trope is number 6, you can't fight fate. Things are a lot simpler if you just can't change the timeline. There are plenty of stories about someone trying to go back in time to prevent some tragedy or disaster, only no matter what they do, they can't seem to stop it. Or worse, they accidentally cause it to happen. The latter case is sometimes known as a stable time loop. Although there's no law of nature that says you have to cause the historical events, only that you can't prevent them. This is the strategy Anne McCaffrey used in Dragonflight, as Lessa's actions in the past are what caused the crisis in the present in the first place. It's the strategy J.K. Rowling used in Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban, where Harry's actions when he goes back in time have already happened to save him from the Dementors, although the movie makes it clearer than the book what's going on. And in fact, these are the rules of time travel suggested by Einstein's theory of general relativity. Relativity says that there's nothing special about the present. In fact, it says that the flow of time itself is an illusion. Rather, the past, present, and future all exist together as a fixed, integrated whole. So if time travel is possible, it won't be able to change anything. The trouble is, this can still lead to paradoxes. If you really want a brain teaser, try Robert Heinlein's By His Bootstraps, where he plays with time at its most confusing. In By His Bootstraps, the time traveler is given a notebook to help him learn the local language when he travels. But he eventually learns that the notebook was given to him by his past self, and he wrote it himself by copying down the older version. And all that's self-consistent, except where did the information come from? The physical paper and ink were acquired in the future and sent back in time, but no one had to record and analyze the language directly in order to write it. The information itself just seemed to come from nowhere. He seems to have lifted himself up by his bootstraps, which is why it's called the bootstrap paradox. The other problem with you can't fight fate is that it is subject to what I call the sufficiently determined time traveler problem. Which is, basically, if you have a time machine that you can use freely, and you can go back as many times as you want to try again, how is the universe going to stop you from changing history every single time? According to general relativity, you still can't, but from an internal view, it seems like an unlimited number of tries should make it impossible to fail. Some scientists like to use this as evidence that time travel is impossible in the real world, if not in so many words. In fiction, authors will often hand-wave this away by saying the same person can't be in two places at once, even though there's no plausible physical law that would prevent that. People do find other workarounds, though. In Arthur C. Clarke's The Light of Other Days, having enough time travel in a given area, or rather past viewing in this story, will create interference that can prevent any more from happening. Connie Willis does say that you can't be in two places at once, but she also adds another limitation, one that is plausible under quantum physics, that if you try to change the past, the time machine will preemptively slip far enough away that you can't do any damage. That's probably the best explanation I've seen, but it's still not completely satisfying to me. But if you think being able to change the timeline is no fun, I have good news. Number 7. You could be in a multiverse with alternate timelines instead. This is the other way to deal with time travel, one that actually manages to avoid all the paradoxes. You see, in the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics, the universe's wave function is constantly splitting into multiple superimposed states whenever a random quantum event occurs, followed by an observation. Every possible timeline occurs simultaneously in the same space as non-interacting quantum waveforms. It's just that we only perceive the reality associated with our particular waveform. I've linked a video from PBS Space Time in the description that explains the many worlds interpretation really well, so check that out for more info. The bottom line is that, with many worlds time travel, whenever you go back in time, you create a new timeline that runs in parallel with your own, and runs with its own perfectly normal causality. If you manage to get back to your original timeline, you'll find that nothing has changed there. No paradox required. Alternate timelines can be tricky. If they're handled badly, this is where you can get your worst continuity problems. Often, characters will find themselves in an alternate timeline, but then have to fix it, as if there's only one timeline, but it's still just as malleable. Star Trek is particularly bad at this, and it's also what you see in Back to the Future. However, if they're handled well, this can make for some really good time travel stories. As I've mentioned before, Avengers Endgame does this really well, where they create new timelines by stealing the Infinity Stones, but they can't change their own. And for that matter, they have to take steps to make sure they don't damage the other timelines too badly. There's also variation depending on how extensive the network of timelines is. Stories that play around with jumping through multiple timelines, or for that matter, even multiple points in history, are relatively rare. Most will deal with just one alternate timeline, or maybe two. Part of this is probably the fact that the more jumping around you do, the more confusing it gets for the reader. Or at the very least, the more complicated it gets, and that also makes it harder to write concisely. The Terminator series does cover multiple timelines, but only across multiple movies. The Butterfly Effect has maybe one of the most complex set of timelines in a single movie. TV shows like Doctor Who or Primeval have the breathing room to do time travel of the week, just like Star Trek's Planet of the Week. But even they mostly don't get more complicated than that within a single episode. And maybe that's a good thing. This is confusing enough as it is. But there is one place where you can find a lot more timelines in one story. It's just a little subtler. Number 8. So far, we've only discussed traveling through time, but there are other things you can do with it. Some works play with altering the flow of time in various ways. And probably the most famous case of this is Groundhog Day. The most famous case of this is Groundhog Day. The most famous case of this is Groundhog Day. Okay, I'm done. In Groundhog Day, Bill Murray goes to bed after a bad day on February 2nd, and he wakes up the next morning to find that it's February 2nd again. He has to relive that day over and over and over. Official word from director Harold Ramis is that it takes 30 or 40 years, until he gets it right and the loop breaks. The idea has since become a trope in its own right, and has appeared in many other movies and TV shows. This is different from the usual time travel, since only the traveler's mind travels back to their earlier body, instead of physically going back into the past. This is really a variant on the unstuck in time idea from Slaughterhouse-5, where the traveler lives life out of order, although in that story, Billy Pilgrim is not able to change the future. The Butterfly Effect is more conventional on that point, where the time traveler jumps to random points in the past, but does get do-overs. That movie also shows how the trope often takes on a horror or thriller tone, also seen in similarly dark films like Premonition and Happy Death Day. But there's another important category of story here, where a character doesn't get many repeated do-overs, but instead gets one long do-over. This kind of story refers back to the 1986 film Peggy Sue Got Married. In that movie, Peggy Sue faints during her 25th high school reunion and wakes up in her younger body during her senior year in high school, where she has to decide if she wants to make the same choices over again. I'd actually never heard of this movie until I started reading fan fiction, but it turns out that it's become a trope in its own right. In fan fiction, a story where a character goes back in time to their younger body at the beginning of the story is called a Peggy Sue story. Somewhat confusingly so, since it has no relation to a Mary Sue. For example, if Harry Potter is ridiculously overpowered, is always right about everything, and wipes the floor with the Death Eaters, that's a Mary Sue. If Harry Potter wakes up one day and he's back in his first year in Hogwarts, that's a Peggy Sue. Although if you're not careful, they could easily end up being the same story. Number 9. There are other ways to play with altering the flow of time even further. These tend to revolve around time running faster or slower or even backwards, but mainly over short intervals of seconds or minutes. The classic example here is the first Superman movie, where Superman flies around the Earth at faster than the speed of light to go back in time far enough to save the day. Christopher Nolan is famous for this, with altered time playing a major role in Inception, Interstellar, and Tenet. And Dunkirk, too, but that's in a narrative sense. In Inception, time runs faster in dreams, and even faster in layered dreams, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but whatever. Tenet features a machine that reverses the flow of time for a person. And Interstellar is the mundane one of the bunch, using ordinary time dilation. And I should note that I've already recommended one book in this category, Christopher Priest's Inverted World. That one plays with altered time in both directions, with time running slower down past and faster up future. Finally, we have number 10, the timey-wimey ball. This is the anything-goes kind of time travel, where it's just there for entertainment and continuity is more of a suggestion, if not ignored entirely. Star Trek and, depending on the writer, Doctor Who, tend to be like this, where they try to have some continuity, but they usually aren't trying that hard. Straight-up comedy can get away with a lot more of this, with things like The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, Futurama, and the aforementioned Mr. Peabody, just going with what's funny, and even playing up the obvious paradoxes for a laugh. And there is definitely a place for this. Time travel is so complicated that it's good to have some place where we can just kick back and have fun with it. It's just that maybe this trope should stay in its lane. And there you have it. 10 major time travel tropes in 30 minutes or less. I think this worked out pretty well, don't you? This has been A Reader's History of Science Fiction. This podcast is available in all the usual places. That still seems redundant to say. I don't get why everyone does it. Anyway, you can find all of my videos on YouTube at Science Meets Fiction. Negative Mass Part 2 should be coming there soon. I'm on Twitter at @SciMeetsFiction. And the rest of my writings are available at sciencemeetsfiction.com. And especially for this episode, I've mentioned far too many titles to list in the description. So instead, I've written a companion blog post listing them all for your perusal. Link below. I decided I couldn't finish a whirlwind tour like this with just one recommendation. Don't worry, I'm not going to do all 10. Besides, if you go back through the previous episodes, you'll find recommendations for at least 4 of them. But I've decided I'm going to give 2 recommendations in this episode, which I think will bookend the range of variations on time travel that you'll see in fiction. My first recommendation is The Time Ships by Stephen Baxter. The Time Ships is the only authorized sequel to H.G. Wells's The Time Machine, commissioned by the Wells estate for the centenary of the original publication in 1995. I've mentioned it before as something that really feels like Wells could have written it if he'd known about modern physics. In this much longer novel, the time traveler prepares to return to the far future to rescue Weena from the Morlocks, only to find himself lost in a many-worlds time stream instead. There are lots of Easter eggs for Wells's other works, and it's one of the best examples I've seen for playing around with multiple timelines. I'll also note that The Time Ships has one of the best endings I've ever read, with everything coming together at exactly the right time and leaving off on exactly the right note. If you're the sort of person to skip ahead and read the ending first, don't. Stick to linear time only on this one, please. You'll thank me later. My second recommendation is for a single television episode, and you might be able to guess it from the title of this episode. It's Blink from Doctor Who. Blink is at the opposite end of the spectrum from the time ships, a single fixed timeline as opposed to many worlds. I consider it the gold standard for those mind-bending time loops and bootstrap paradoxes that you get with a fixed timeline, as Sally Sparrow must rely on messages from the past and the future to evade the terrifying weeping angels, who, by the way, are some of the best monsters ever invented. If you haven't seen Blink, you really need to. In the next episode, we have an interview. I will be interviewing Annie Giever, author of the Undead Age Trilogy, a new series about a zombie apocalypse. Book 3 just released in May, so it's pretty near hot off the press in publishing terms. Come and check it out. And remember, don't turn your back, don't look away, and don't blink. Good luck.